Okay, settle in, settle down, get ready for another episode of The Nostalgia Trap. I am your host, David Parsons. Thanks so much for joining me. I appreciate it. I have a great conversation with a wonderful historian for you today. His name is Timothy J. Lombardo. Check out his work. He has a book out that I think would interest anybody who listens to The Nostalgia Trap and who's interested in 20th century American politics in particular. His book is called Blue Collar Conservatism, Frank Rizzo's Philadelphia and Populist Politics. And I bet you can tell from the title that it has a lot to do with Frank Rizzo, the mayor of Philadelphia in the 1970s, who, if you know anything about Frank Rizzo in Philadelphia, you know the kind of racial working class politics that he pushed, a really critical part of understanding the 20th century, understanding the politics of the Trump era, etc., is understanding what went on in Philadelphia in the 70s. So Professor Lombardo's book is something you should check out and pick up. And this conversation with him, you know, we talk about everything. We do the nostalgia trap. He's from Philadelphia, so I wanted to hear, of course, like kind of how Philadelphia impacted his thinking about all this politics and living through that, through the kind of tail end of that era. So I hope you enjoyed this conversation. This is a really fun one. I really got into kind of like the idea of the so-called white working class that I think the left likes to talk about a lot, and how complicated that gets when it intersects with the politics of policing, racial politics, and all that kind of stuff. So I hope you enjoy this conversation. There's lots more Nostalgia Trap stuff out there. Please check out nostalgiatrap.com. That's where we keep all our episodes. And you can also click on our Patreon link to subscribe to the show. We need more subscribers. We need your support. If you're not supporting the show, please think about throwing a few dollars our way. $5 a month. Probably isn't something that will mean a whole lot to you unless you have very little money. And if so, why are you donating to podcasts at all? Don't subscribe to any podcast if you don't have any money. But if $5 is no big deal and you enjoy the work we do, we'd really appreciate your support. And you can do that again at patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. It means a lot to us and keeps the project going with interviews with historians and radicals and all sorts of people. As we move through the continued nightmare of 2019 and late capitalism. So thanks for the people that are supporting the show. I hope you enjoy this conversation. Let's get to it. Here is me talking with historian Timothy Lombardo. So, you know, I'm really glad to talk to you because I think that as we get to know you and your work, I think we'll learn that your work intersects with a lot of the bigger interests of this program, which, you know, a lot of stuff about American politics in the late 20th century, the intersection of race and class, urban politics, policing and all that kind of stuff. But Timothy Lombardo, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
You're from the place that you study. Your book is and tell me the title of your book.
The book's title is Blue Collar Conservatism, Frank Rizzo's Philadelphia and Populist Politics.
Which, again, I think people who listen to this program should get this book and kind of connect it to all the things we talk about. It seems like it's almost tailored for us. So again, thanks for joining us. The Philadelphia connection, I think that's the kind of entryway into your work. I want to talk about it. Kind of like you're from Philadelphia, right?
I am born and raised. I mean, I now live currently live in Mobile, Alabama. I teach at the University of South Alabama, but I was born and raised in Philadelphia. I mean, and I'm actually, you know, quite pointed about I was born and raised in Philadelphia, not surrounding Philadelphia, not in the suburbs. I was born and raised in Philadelphia. I was educated. I went to school for 12 years in Philadelphia. I did my undergrad and my master's degree at Temple University in Philadelphia. And I only left Philly in 2007 when I went to work on my PhD at Purdue. So, no, yeah, I didn't leave my hometown until I was 28 years old, 27 or 28.
So it seems like Philly is a place that feels like you're close to. You have an intimate connection with.
Absolutely, Philadelphia will always be home. No matter where I go, Philadelphia will always be home. I'm deeply connected to the city, to its politics, and to its history. And, you know, I think I tried to let that come out a little bit in the book, that, like, this is a place that matters and that I'm familiar with, in addition to being a scholar. That leads to a lot of, you know, you got to be careful with stuff like that. You can't let your familiarity cloud the archival record.
Of course.
But it does. There were certain advantages I would never give up.
Were you how surprising is it to you that you ended up writing a book about Philadelphia? In other words, like, at what point in your life did you know that kind of studying the place you're from and the kind of politics that surrounded it and it sounds like the specific era that you're writing about is kind of an era very, very close to ours. I mean, it's yeah. You know, the 1970s and 80s. So at what point are you feeling like Philadelphia is something that you want to dedicate, you know, a part of your life to studying?
I think it probably came a little later than it might for most. This like a lot of people, like a lot of historians, my first book was my dissertation. Mm-hmm. And I did not go to grad school with the intent of writing on Philadelphia. And in fact, I had an entirely different dissertation planned out and started researching that for one reason or another, I just started to not feel confident in. Mm. And
I think it's a common experience in grad school. I think that, that happened to me and a lot of other people around me in history departments. They kind of found a topic and then ultimately ditched that one and found another one.
And that's precisely what happened. For me, it was the last seminar I took before exams. It was a seminar taught by Darren Dochuk on the history of modern conservatism. And something in there just like stuck with me. Mm. And especially what stuck with me is that I thought there was something missing. Mm. Like we read great books by, you know, Kevin Kruse, Matt Lasseter, all the ones that were really popular and really good at the last decade.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But like they were all about the South, or they were all about the West, or they were all about the suburbs. And I started thinking, well, I don't know, this doesn't remind me of the kind of conservatives I know home.
Yeah.
And it was right at that time that I was having this sort of, you know, that crisis that all grad students go through when you're not certain about your topic. And I remember going to my advisor and saying, I think I want to switch my – I mean, this was late. I was I had already passed – I didn't pass comps yet, but I had already done I had a proposal written. I had all this stuff, and I had done some research for it. I came to her and I said, I think I want to change my topic. And, you know, I explained why. And I said, I think I want to write about Philadelphia. And she was very, very encouraging about that, about, you know, there's mm-hmm. an advantage in writing what you know.
Yeah.
And I never, like I said, it was never in my intent. I didn't start with that idea. But it was a great decision. I mean, it as a grad student, it allowed me to do things a lot cheaper than a lot of my other colleagues.
That's nice. So yeah,
I got to crash at my sister's house and at my parents' house and stuff like that, and I got to see friends all the time, mm-hmm. which probably slowed me down more than it could have.
Well, what were the years that you were doing your PhD? What years did that span?
I defended in summer of 2013. So I guess I was actually just talking about this today with a grad student here. I think I wrote my prospectus in the fall of 2009. Mm-hmm. I think.
Yeah.
So I think I was just realizing that I'm just now 10 years, getting close to 10 years since I wrote the prospectus for what would become eventually the book.
It's insane. And it lines up exactly with my experience. And I wanted to ask you, like, kind of like, it seems like conservatism was the path back to Philadelphia for you. You know, that kind of like the political element was what drew you back and your interest back. So what was your relationship to conservatism? Because like I ended up, you know, going. I went to grad school the same years as you, and I think I defended in 2013 too. And, you know, my experience was, you know, the grad school were the Bush and Obama years, and a lot of like anti-war stuff, a lot of Occupy Wall Street, and it was happening, Black Lives Matter. And I was thinking a lot about the left, and I ended up writing about the left, but you ended up writing about the right. And so what is it about conservatism that drew your interest as a historian?
Well, like I said, it really was that seminar.
Yeah.
I'd largely started out in grad school thinking I was a historian of the left too. I remember starting out thinking, you know, I remember my grad school applications talking about, I'm a historian of American radicalism. And that's when, you know, a lot of my early grad school papers were about radicalism. And it really was this seminar, that changed my outlook. This was for me, the tail end of the Bush years going into the Obama years. Mm-hmm. And I think that all compounded it. Like, it was the historical, the history of something I hadn't really considered yet. That, you know, a lot of that was new. But then it was, this is also the history of my time. Mm. This is the history. And it was like, well, there seemed to be so much left to do, including like what I think I did, which was, you know, a different kind of conservatism than you find in other parts of the country. When you look at somewhere that's urban, when you look at somewhere in the north, and when you look at somewhere that like Philadelphia. And so,
so what is that conservatism that you see in Philadelphia? What's it, what's different about it? How would you describe that?
So that is the crux of the book. Is when I say blue collar conservatism in the book, I'm saying I'm identifying a variant of conservatism, kind of based in a populist sensibility that is unique. Mm-hmm. That is, and not necessarily unique to Philadelphia, but definitely unique to urban political systems and among within populations that are largely working and lower middle class, white ethnic. Mm. And within that, I call blue collar conservatism is this, this variant of modern conservatism that comes out of two dual interests. And one is what I call a selective rejection of welfare liberalism. By that I mean these are people who do not reject the New Deal liberal state outright. They selectively reject it based on who they think is and is not deserving of governmental support.
Mm-hmm.
And the other equally important strain of blue-collar conservatism is a promotion of law and order, of law or law enforcement conservatism. So it's very much emphasis on the police, on law enforcement politics, and that's especially, I mean, in both cases, but this is where Rizzo made an especially interesting person to put at the center of my work.
Yeah, it's you know, when hearing the you describe this kind of conservatism, the what pops into my head are like, you know, certain cultural stereotypes. I think, I mean, like Archie Bunker, you know,
yeah.
The kind of like image of this like kind of you know, curmudgeonly an angry, bigoted, you know, white ethnic, suburban or urban person who is kind of like repulsed by the cultural change of the 1960s, civil rights movement. In other words, it's often framed as kind of like a backlash type figure.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I even have a line somewhere in the book about how Archie Bunker would have felt right at home in Frank Rizzo's Philadelphia.
Yeah.
But I also try to complicate that backlash narrative. That's the narrative that has been told a lot. And I try to complicate it by really, first of all, contextualizing this political development within the so-called urban crisis of the 60s and 70s. And part of it is certainly part of that racial backlash, that a lot of what I write about is the response to the civil rights movement, mm-hmm. response to civil rights legislation, response to civil rights agitation. But the other main intervention and the other reason I come up with this term, blue-collar conservatism, is because the people I'm writing about, by and large, are steadfastly refusing to admit these are racial politics.
Mm-hmm.
And instead, I mean, a lot of the term of blue-collar conservatism comes from the political language that they use, in which, and I argue that they sort of learn from the past, and they stop using explicitly segregationist terms, and they stop using racist language, and they start talking about class.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and that's another part of this. It's about class identity. And in a lot of ways, what I say in the book is that blue collar identity, this promotion of, you know, authenticity of authentic blue collar neighborhood life was in and of itself a form of identity politics that we don't often acknowledge, because mm-hmm. these are white identity politics.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But hiding behind, and I'm not even necessarily hiding. I like, it's not like they're a veneer of class. Class is very important, but it's a racially backed or racially saturated but class forward type of policy.
Right, which anticipates a kind of an image of the Trump base, right?
I was reluctant to first of all, I defended this before Trump was, when this was a dissertation, I never had Trump in mind.
Yeah, yeah.
And then all of a sudden, right as I was finishing final drafts of the manuscript, you know, it's the question is, are you going to, you know, my editor and reviewers was, are you going to address Trump? And I didn't want to.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't, but eventually I had to, especially, you know, in 2016, his son is on the campaign trail calling his father a blue collar billionaire.
Mm.
And I was like, well, and so what I always say is that
that seems like, what does that mean, blue collar billionaire? It seems like it's like that identity thing, right? It's like, yeah, it
has far more to do with identity than it does class status.
And does like, blue collar mean white to people? Do a lot of people? I mean, it seems like that's often like the kind of code word, like blue collar means white, even though like at this point in like 2019, the working class is like predominantly like people of color more than any category. But it seems like blue collar seems like it carries some kind of racial baggage, right?
I think that it does. Yes.
Yeah.
And so the bulk of my study takes place in the 1970s. And Philadelphia is particularly an interesting place for this study because, you know, in a lot of ways, Philadelphia has this sort of reputation as being a blue-collar city.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, it really earns that reputation in the 1970s just as, like a lot of cities, industries leaving.
Mm-hmm.
The traditional blue-collar employment is no longer the base of the city, but that identity and that sort of that perception of blue collar remains. And I think absolutely that the 70s is where you start to begin to see a lot more of that shift. You see a lot, you know, a lot more blue collar people of color, and the working class is significantly more diverse. It's always been diverse, but it's more pronounced, it's more acknowledged. But the term blue collar, I don't know if I would say exclusively, but is primarily used to discuss white workers
mm-hmm.
and the white working and lower middle class. And so yes, I think blue collar then, and I think to a large extent now, is still used as a signifier for race. Mm-hmm. I think it's a way of saying I'm talking about the white working class,
right?
Right, I think so. Yeah.
I'm remembering now. Was it during the McCain and Palin campaign? Joe the Plumber. Yeah, right.
Was like not blue collar by any economic standpoint whatsoever.
Yeah, he's making 200 grand a year or something like that. Yeah,
right. And that's another thing I say. You can say the same thing about Trump or a lot of people. Like I kind of say in my book, when I'm talking about class here, I'm not talking about traditional notions of, you know, how Marx would have understood the working class or other people. And, you know, I'm saying this is a cultural identity as much as an economic factor or an economic designator.
Right. And I mean, it seems like the era that you're studying in the 70s is when I think of that era and I think of particularly these like deindustrializing Northeast cities like Boston and New York and Philadelphia. Yeah. And the entire Rust Belt. I'm thinking a lot about kind of like, especially in New York and Boston, and I think Philadelphia too, like the busing controversies and like, mm-hmm. You know, the kind of like, I don't know, the intersection of like the kind of liberal, the intersection of like liberal race policy and this kind of growing conservative backlash.
Right, exactly right.
And so I mean, how is that playing out in Philadelphia?
So, I mean, so... anything that's, you hit on something that, like, my book's about Philadelphia, but it's a much broader story.
Yeah.
It plays out in Philadelphia, I think, most directly through the career of Frank Rizzo. Frank Rizzo, if you're not familiar, if anyone's not familiar, fills a lot of holes for these people who are feeling left out by these liberal policies, by civil rights policies, and all those pressures. Frank Rizzo in the 1960s worked his way, was a cop, worked his way up to police commissioner, and he earned a well-deserved reputation for harsh, for over-aggressive tactics and police brutality, and he parlayed that into a political career. He served two terms as mayor, where he was purposely antagonistic to liberals, divisive. He was a Democrat, and he was a divisive figure. He endorses Nixon. He's opposing busing. He promises that no neighborhood that doesn't want public housing is going to have public housing built in that neighborhood. All of these things that are directly engaged in all of the politics that had really aroused blue collar whites in the 60s, right? And so they kind of put their hopes into him. And you know, if you read Jeff Cowie's really, really great, I really love Jeff Cowie's book, Last Days of the Working Class, Staying Alive. Mm-hmm. But he kind of sees this, he sees the 70s as sort of this fall of the working class in a lot of ways. But there's, before the fall, I think, at least especially in somewhere like Philadelphia, there's a celebration. You know, he's their guy. Like they very specifically, they refer to him as one of us. You know, he was the beat cop, working class kid who worked his way up, became police commissioner. Now he's mayor. He represents, you know, quote, one of us. And so that is a triumph. You know, and he stops, he's halting busing. He's stopping public housing, at least for the time being. Most of these victories are fleeting. But for those few years in the 70s, this was someone they could see get these like sort of these momentary triumphs or vicarious victories through him, and it's most of what I focus on are those people who saw that in him, as their hope, as the one person said, the savior of the city.
Wow, and it's, so you're looking at kind of his coalition, his fans, his, mm-hmm. the people that were supporting him.
Absolutely,
yeah.
I'm pretty insistent on saying this is not a biography of Frank Rizzo. That's it's not what I did. I'm at heart. I think I'm a social historian at heart, mm-hmm. And he's a great window to all these things. But mostly, I'm talking about the people who loved him. And I mean, like, and that's the thing. If you know anything about Rizzo, he's. You know, he's one of the most controversial people in the city's history. And, you know, most people who know him or have ever written about him are really critical of him.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say, that he seems like, and I don't know if this is maybe the character of his name even, you know, that like he seems like a villain in the story, in the sense of someone who's almost like a Northeast Coast a Bull Connor, you know, someone who's like
George Wallace, Bull Connor. I mean,
right.
So there are a lot. People draw that comparison to him all the time. I mean, there's a large number of people who compare him to Mussolini because he's Italian.
Or Joe Arpaio, I think, comes to mind as well. The kind of like merger of the kind of racialized police tactics with actually. Being mayor or having like a lot of political power,
right? And so he is often painted as that villain. And I am clear in the book that I don't disagree with any of that. Like I'm not out to point out like right. no. Here's these other side. I'm just saying
this isn't a hagiography in the other direction.
Yeah, that there are people who loved him.
Yeah,
and just because even if we disagree with them, their history matters. Because they are really foreshadowing some major developments in American political history.
Oh, definitely. I think I agree with that. I mean, and even if you didn't, you know, I think it's I don't envy you that the kind of your book being published, you know, right around the time the Trump thing was coming out, because it's so complicated to unpack. But I do actually, you know, I think that you don't need it, because when I saw when I see the cover of your book and I look at what it's about, the reader can immediately draw those connections that, like, this isn't a biography of Frank Rizzo, but a kind of like a window into a certain kind of politics in America.
Yeah, and that's what I was always going for. I'm glad that comes through, because that's really what I wanted this to be. I wanted, you know, Rizzo is a good hook. He's mm-hmm. a great narrative hook, mm-hmm. and I'll be perfectly honest. you refer to him as a villain. It is as a writer, it's sometimes fun to write about those guys.
Yeah.
Because we're
finding that out about Trump, right? I mean, that people there's something, I don't know, there's something darkly humorous about everything that's going on, especially if you kind of, the more you understand about American history and the direction of American politics, the absurdity of some of these figures. And I think humor is part of, I don't know. We talked about it, like,
humor.
Yeah, the dark humor is part of a fascist project too. So it's kind of weird.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. No, it is. It certainly is. But just as from a purely writing standpoint.
Oh, it's great.
You know, it's a good it's a good narrative device to have somebody who says outlandish things.
He's like a professional wrestler.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very quotable. Yeah.
I mean, I didn't really write about this too much in the book, but like Rizzo was known for just like outlandish quotes.
Yeah.
And so he made a number of enemies, and one of them was the Americans for a Democratic Society, the Philadelphia branch of Americans for a Democratic Society. And it was in 1977 they published a book of Frank Rizzo's sayings. Called "I Never Saw My Mother Naked," or the sayings of Chairman Frank, and it, you know, it's like kind of a play on Chairman Mao.
Yeah,
it's a fascinating little book. And I mean, and just you read the quotes in it, and they're, you know, some liberal's gonna jump off the a nearby bridge. He gets elected, and he just says incredible things, incredibly offensive things too. But
well, is that part of the strategy, and that's part of his political appeal, like that kind of, like, I don't know, Howard Stern, Donald Trump kind of the feeling of like, what are they going to say next, and that outlandishness is part of the power, it seems like.
Yes,
especially identifying with like working class people, and like, you know, almost trolling liberals by being offensive.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know if I want it with Trump. I'm not in Trump. With Rizzo, I don't know if I want to go as far and say it was a strategy. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know if he was doing it on purpose or if he was just
But
in terms of his appeal, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Because he talked like, you know, quoting them, he talked like one of us.
Right.
You know,
right.
During 2016, you know, when there's all this confusion, how does the media trying to find out why do people like Trump? And the thing you hear over and over and over again is, he says it like it is.
Yeah, right.
You know, that's what Rizzo was doing. That's what they're saying it like it is. And it's like, and that is that. I mean, unpack that term any way you want. You know, they're not saying it what it is. They're saying what you want to hear.
Right. Yeah. And they're appealing. And they're appealing to a particular constituency. I mean, did Rizzo care at all about the black vote at all?
Not until much, much later in his career.
Right.
When he first runs for mayor, he runs in 1971, and on the advice of his campaign, he just avoids it. He'd become a lightning rod for civil rights activists, and with some pretty high profile raids on the Black Panthers, raids on Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in the city. What was termed a police riot. When a school board demonstration in 1967. Mm. So he was wildly unpopular throughout Black Philadelphia, and so his campaign staff said, you know, concentrate on Northeast Philadelphia, concentrate on South Philadelphia, concentrate on these white ethnics, and he's able to edge out a victory. In fact, really 71 belies national trends, and a lot of the African American vote goes to the Republican. Mm. In 1971.
Wow.
And that you know, that remains that way throughout much of the 70s. And in the late 70s, you know, Rizzo's kind of sees the end of his term is coming, and he just, I mean, it's like you back one of these guys into a box and or back in the corner, and then they're just going to lash out even further. And he starts talking about when he's done being mayor, he's going to start a new movement for white ethnic rights. You know, a white ethnic movement.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's not really racial code. You know what I mean?
No. That's what I said. There's this colorblind veneer through most of the 70s.
But he takes the mask off at some point.
At some point, like he just gets. I guess he's getting frustrated, yeah. and it culminates in he changes his mind. He says he wants to change the city charter, so that he can run for a third term as mayor. Mm. And it quickly this becomes a referendum on his entire career. And he's at a rally of supporters, and it's also a rally that's been fighting public housing. And he says to the crowd, so I'm going to say to he says something like something towards the effect of, you hear my opponents and they're all saying vote black, vote black, vote black. Well, I say to the people who are in this room, vote white.
Oh, God. So like, yeah.
He could not be more explicit.
Did his supporters eventually, you know, reject him, or were the, you know, did he pay a political price for that, or was that always so, there?
It was always there. It was always beneath the surface.
Yeah.
The vote white scandal, he tried to backpedal and say he didn't mean it. And it will still be an incredibly close vote. But it is at that point, the single highest African-American voter turnout in Philadelphia history.
Mm, wow.
And the amendment is defeated.
Yeah.
Rizzo will make a series of attempts to get back. And in 1983... he will lose the Democratic primary race to the man who will go on to be the first African-American mayor of Philadelphia, Wilson Good.
Yep.
And in 1987, he will run as a Republican for the first time against Wilson Good and lose again. And he'll run one final time in 1991, and he'll die on the campaign trail.
Jesus. How did he die?
Heart attack. Ugh. Just exhaustion, heart, like just. I mean, he was a really big guy, and you know, he smoked all the time. I think he was still smoking up until the day he died.
Yeah, that's my image of him.
But he it was in that last campaign, for the first time, he was actually reaching out to African Americans, and you know, after the '80s, and the '80s were pretty bad for Philly.
That's the move bombing is in the '80s, right?
The move bombing, but also the crack epidemic.
Yep.
And a lot of things that were taking that were ravaging cities in the '80s, mm-hmm. and like, no one knows what would have happened if he would have won, but for the first time, people were like, you know, kind of listening to him, and like, you know, in '83 he comes out and he says, oh, there's a new Rizzo, and nobody buys it. Nobody buys it in '87. But in 91, he's like, well, maybe he's reformed, maybe he, and then he dies. So
what is Rizzo's image in Philadelphia now?
Depends on who you ask.
I assume so. Are there a lot of people that still kind of heroize the guy?
Yes. Yeah. But one of the things I say in my book, so one of the things though that one of the first casualties of Frank Rizzo's politics was his own political career, because when he left. When he left office, white flight increases in Philadelphia in the 80s and 90s. So Philadelphia has a distinction among cities of its type in that white flight does not affect – I mean, there's white flight beginning in the 50s. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But it's not all to the suburbs. Philadelphia – there's a part of Philadelphia, northeast Philadelphia, that in the 1950s was still more farmland than housing. And when that opens up and it becomes, you know, it's 90% white into the 1970s, 1980s. These are Rizzo people, but they're still in the city, right?
Mm-hmm,
and it's when Rizzo leaves, you start seeing all these people say, I just don't feel safe anymore. And that's when they move to Montgomery County, to New Jersey, to Delaware County and all that.
And that
for what it's worth.
Yeah.
For what it's worth. Northeast Philadelphia is one of the center, like the big neighborhood case study in the book, or one of the big ones, and it is where I'm from.
Mm.
I grew up in Northeast. Philadelphia.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you is, you know, kind of what was your own personal relationship to this conservatism and even Frank Rizzo? At what point do you remember, like, the first time you heard Rizzo's name, and like, was it kind of thrown around in your house a lot, or yeah. You know, what is, you know, how does conservatism enter your life in Philadelphia?
So I was 12 when he died. So I was never old enough to be to participate or to really understand it. I remember him losing in 1987, and I remember him being very angry on TV and being. But I didn't, you know, have enough to piece that together. I did not grow up in a Rizzo household, at least not my parents.
Household. I love that.
Yeah, no, there. I mean, it was, you know, in the 70s.
Like an identifiable subset of people.
Oh, the joke that is, if you went to especially an Italian American house in the 70s. You know, right next to you'd have on the wall, you'd see Frank Sinatra and Frank Rizzo.
Wow.
Those would be the two portraits.
The two Franks.
So my parents were not Rizzo. In fact, my father always tells me that the very first vote he ever cast was against Frank Rizzo in 1971. It was the very first time he ever voted. So they were never Frank Rizzo people. My extended family was.
Ah, I see.
Is.
Yeah.
Is, I should say.
Was and is, yeah.
It was and is.
They've got the two Frank portraits on their wall.
And that Venn diagram between Frank Rizzo voters and Trump voters.
Yeah.
That's a lot of my.
That's what I was going to ask. It's kind of like this white ethnic population, the kind of like conventional wisdom. And I think my own experience in living in New York City for many years is that population is being increasingly, you know, kind of diffused through American culture. And there's not like the wave of like Italian and Slavic immigrants coming to the United States in the as they were in the middle of the century. So you have this the result of that is that this population is kind of going away. My wife's family is in South Brooklyn, and they're like, you know, an Italian American family that you know, they would have like the Frank Sinatra picture on the wall, and the kind of like, you know, all of that, but that community and that culture seems like it's not as strong as it once was. Is that true?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, like, so I can't answer this with as much authority. I will, it's more anecdotal.
Yeah.
You know,
It seems like the politics are still there.
The politics are there, but white ethnics have always had the option, you know? not always, but like in this yes. They have the option, you know, and as white ethnics intermarried and you know, and stuff like that. So, you know,
what do you mean by the option? The option to like embrace a certain ethnic identity or just be like a regular American white person that eats like hamburgers and French fries.
The option of both.
Yeah.
The historical option to embrace ethnicity or not.
Yeah.
Hold on. I'm sorry.
No problem. Busy working historians.
Yeah. I don't, you know what? My phone never, no, I don't know. That's my phone and my. Yeah, I can't do this. Shoot, I don't know how to shut this off. I never answered my phone.
Huh. Are you in your office?
Yeah, I'm out on campus today. I don't know how to shut it off.
Yeah.
All right, there it goes. We'll go to voicemail. All right, I don't. Who uses office telephones anymore? Just send an email.
Yeah,
I apologize for that.
Yeah, no problem. I had the same thing in my office phone. When it rang, I kind of stared at it like, who would call? Like, who even knows this number?
Right. Why is it?
Yeah.
We were talking about white ethnic identity.
And it kind of like how
option of embracing when you want, and so it can be ceremonial.
Uh-huh.
And so I think there's still some aspects when it's really ceremonial and really pronounced. But when it doesn't need to be, it isn't, you know?
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. No, totally.
But there are still pockets of South Philadelphia that are still heavily Italian and stuff like that. And interested, like, you know, in one of these, where do Trump voters live? That section of South Philadelphia, which was one of the sections I wrote about, it was like something like 90% of this neighborhood voted for Trump in Philly. And Philly went something – I forget what it was. I think Philly went like 98% for Clinton or something like that, but 90% of this one neighborhood.
Well, that's another thing I was going to ask about that, you know, I noticed in your work, and that connects to even, you know, my own experience in Brooklyn is the kind of like deeper you go into those kinds of neighborhoods, the more I would see like a kind of outward expression of solidarity with the police. Lots of bumper stickers that were pro police, and lots of like even like Blue Lives Matter type flags and things like that in recent years as a like direct kind of response to Black Lives Matter. So like what's going on with that? What is that kind of like that, police connection? Because that seems like it's obviously, you know, tied up with Frank Rizzo.
Oh, absolutely. And it is, but it also predates him a little bit. I mean, yeah. Rizzo is that's a big part of the 60s, even before Rizzo's a really known entity, when he's just working his way up. No, blue collar support for the police is a central tenet of everything I write about in the book. And it comes out of accusations against the police from African Americans, the civil rights movement heating up, and all these things. And there's two ways to look at it. One, they're supporting the police because the police are that like last line of, you know, white racial protection.
Right.
And that's a big part of it. But also remember, and it's one of the things we often forget when we talk about policing, is policing's also a job.
Yeah, right.
And it's a heavily white, blue-collar job. If you look at it's a job that especially a white guy can get out of high school in the 60s without a college degree and provide a pretty stable middle-class upbringing. And in a city like Philly, and with a really strong fraternal order of police that are getting good, you know, better salaries and raises and all of those things, this is the one of the things I say in the book. There were few professions or few jobs in blue collar Philadelphia more blue collar than police work. And so
so it's their family members, and that's why you're. I mean, I always assume that. And even when I see bumper stickers that are like support our troops or support particular branches of the military and things like that, I always assume that there's a family connection or a friend or something like that. You know, there's a personal connection to that stuff, and that makes total sense. Yeah,
I mean, they're not. I mean, it's tradition in some families. You know, father was a cop, my brother, my uncle was a cop, I gotta be a cop. I mean, that
right.
And you see that,
right.
But it's not. It's families, it's neighborhoods. You know, so in the 1960s, Philadelphia still had the Philadelphia City Charter still says that police officers must live within the city limits. Well, police officers, like what you know, were especially white police officers were a huge group of those who were moving to Northeast Philadelphia,
right.
Setting up roots in an area that was a little bit more like the suburbs, a little bit quieter than the inner city, and they were building relationships with other, you know, white neighbors. And so increasingly, where you have, you know, the police that are African American newspapers and the. And the NAACP and Congress of Racial Equality, the police that they're talking about, these are a force in their communities. That's not the police that's operating in white neighborhoods. These are friends. These are neighbors. These are family. These are breadwinners. And increasingly, when they're defending them, they're defending them not as, you know, protectors of a white racial order, but as people who have a hard job to do, an objectively hard job to do. And, you know, when they defend police brutality by saying, you know, this is a hard job. Sometimes things happen.
Oh, believe me, I've heard all of that. Yeah.
And it becomes a very big part, not only of saying police brutality doesn't exist. You know, all of this is, I mean, they're being presented with evidence and saying, I don't believe this is true because I don't see it.
Right.
I know, officer. So and so, you know, they're not like that. I'm quoting people in the book who say, "I don't believe things are as bad as they say."
Right.
You know, that kind of
and you see that now. I mean, you see that in the kind of Trump voter type attitude. Yeah.
It's in this. I chalk it up in my book to sort of like the spatial segregation of Philadelphia, a hyper segregated city. That support for the police really, really. I mean, I think it's. I mean, you know, you see the thin blue line flag on a bumper sticker.
Right.
You probably know how that person voted. You know.
Yes. Yeah. That's my assumption always. I feel like it goes hand in hand with either like an NRA sticker or a Make America Great Again hat.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Right.
Feels like that.
I
mean, so
I tend. Yeah.
your connection to Rizzo's connection to Nixon seems like it makes a lot of sense, and kind of like connecting this to kind of like the broader national trend. And I wanted to ask you, kind of like, you've probably heard of like the hard hat riot, or the kind of like moment where I've mentioned on the show many times, and there's a great book by Penny Lewis called Hard Hats, Hippies and Hawks that takes that on.
I know it.
So I wondered how that squares with the Rizzo stuff, because what Penny Lewis argues in that book is that like Nixon essentially exploited this idea of the working class being conservative and really like kind of distorted the image that all working class blue collar white people were like, patriotic supporters of the war effort, when the actual reality was a lot more complicated, considering the fact that many labor unions were against the war, especially smaller ones. And like working class people had their kids dying in the war. So like, of course, like many of them were like really opposed to the war because of that. So, I mean, how does that square with your kind of work looking at working class people in Philadelphia?
So, and I think I'm pretty sure she makes the same argument as that I do, is that we can't, that you're right, that Nixon does conflate all of white labor.
Right.
And that's not who the hard hats were.
Right.
The hard hats were specifically the building and trade unions, in that case mostly in New York City, but the same thing in Philadelphia, and they are different.
Mm-hmm.
The building and trade unions have, these are your unions that use their position in a local labor market to completely control the workforce.
Yeah, they're powerful unions, and those ones supported the war.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. These are the powerful unions. These are the ones that support the war, and these were the ones. So they're a big part of my story because one of the first, or the first, fully formed affirmative action program in U.S. history was the Philadelphia Plan.
Oh yeah, please tell us about the Philadelphia Plan.
It was first designed during the Johnson administration to ensure equal representation or fair representation on federal work projects. And the 60s, you have urban renewal, you have highway construction. I mean, this is construction work is not only prevalent, it is high wages for blue collar work, and it is relatively steady, backed by federal guarantees and high wages. And so it becomes central to African Americans to get into these positions, but the building trades have a lock on the training processes, which they claim is they need to ensure good quality work. But much like the police department, to get into the building trades, you need a sponsor, and they tend to be friends and relatives and people from the neighborhood. And so the building trades are almost all white. The building trades are Rizzo people. There's actually an episode
that makes sense. Yep.
There's an episode that doesn't make it into the book, and it's like there's so many things I wish I could have written, but at some point you got to cut it off. But the Philadelphia Inquirer runs a satirical critical article of Rizzo in the early 70s, and the building trades, in response, come out and blockade the newspaper building, so people can't get in or out, and they protest it for like 2 days.
Wow. Yeah.
And they ask, well, I'm just out here to help Frank.
Yeah.
Because they one of us type of things.
God.
And so when Nixon is making these appeals to, you're right, he's absolutely conflating in a much larger working class that has far greater diversity of thought and all like that. But he's using this one small group that is incredibly powerful, both in New York and in Philadelphia, the building trades, who are at least in some ways part of that hard hat backlash.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And Nixon fully sees Rizzo as his key to that vote. He considered Nixon key to his urban strategy. Mm. He had a southern strategy. This was an urban strategy. Those Archie Bunker types, those white ethnics, those people who were who didn't like busing and all those, that was Rizzo, all sorts of questions about whether or not they should embrace him even further. They met a lot. Rizzo reciprocated. He called Nixon the greatest president in American history.
Yeah.
And it was great for Nixon, because here's a Democratic mayor of a big city calling me the best president. So he embraced this. It was, I mean, Rizzo went out of his way to campaign for Nixon. He carried around in 72, he carried around a rubber chicken with a McGovern pin on it.
And yeah, it sounds like for a while though, Rizzo is like, is identifying and running as a Democrat, right?
Oh no, he's a Democrat.
Yeah. So what makes him what kind of arguments does he make? What makes him a Democrat at that moment?
So, you know,
especially if he's like so openly supportive of Richard Nixon, who's like kind of expanding the power of the Republican Party using this kind of racial strategy.
There are two things going on here.
Yeah.
One, the Democratic Party is far more ideologically mixed than at this point in time, and you know it's not uncommon to find these still very conservative Democrats, both North and South.
Uh-huh.
For Rizzo, however, Rizzo actually had been a lifelong Republican, and a lot of this dates back to family ties. You know, if you go back to early in the 20th century. Italian immigrants, including Rizzo's parents, found help through a Republican machine. Mm. And so a lot of Italians remained loyal to the Republican Party in Philadelphia way later than they did in other big cities. But Rizzo only ever switches his affiliation in 1967 when he becomes police commissioner for a Democratic mayor. Mm. The Republican Party thinks about drafting him in 71. But he's got enough ins with the Democratic establishment to stay as a Democrat. And the Democratic Party issues a primary challenge in 75. He's got more opposition from Democrats than Republicans during his entire administration. And so when he goes back when he changes party in 87 to be a Republican, it's almost like going back to where he always was.
Yeah.
You know?
That makes sense.
For Rizzo, the Democratic Party was political expediency. At the same time, though, he still embraced strong unions, which is something, you know, in Philadelphia politics you had to do. He still embraced unions. And like a lot of people, he didn't fundamentally dislike the welfare state. He wasn't an ideologue that opposed those kind of
That's such a great indication of how far right the dial has moved in American politics. When you're thinking about like a Rizzo character, it's like, well, ultimately this guy that like exploited, you know, some of the worst racial tendencies in order to like gain power. He also was like pro-union and very much supported the liberal welfare state. You're like, what? Like, that doesn't seem like even a character that could fit or exist in today's politics.
That's one of the sentences why I call it like it's a selective rejection of welfare liberalism. I mean,
right.
parts of it that helped his constituents.
Yeah.
Like there's a neighborhood that in South Philadelphia that I profile a lot that is fighting a decades long battle over public housing. At the same time, they're like working extra hard for urban renewal funds and all this other federal money.
Right.
The neighborhood with the largest amount of federal money put into it by the early 70s, and it's like, here's the one thing but they deserve it because we earned it. You know, we worked hard, we earned it. Mm-hmm. Public housing, tenants still, and that's Rizzo was just a reflection of that.
Right.
You know.
Right.
He. I mean, that has a lot more to do with urban politics, I think, than anything than ideology. I mean, like, you know, urban areas in the 60s and 70s. We're still pretty dependent on a lot of that federal funding for federal money coming into construction and stuff like that. And so I think that was, for him, more expediency than anything else.
Yeah. Yeah. That's so I wanted to ask you, you know, all that Rizzo stuff is just fascinating. I mean, to me, it's like it is like a lens into a certain kind of politics that. You do see, like, you mentioned Kevin Cruz, like White Flight, like that book. To me, like, is a picture of a certain kind of conservatism, a certain kind of racial backlash in the South. But you've identified something that I think a lot more historians are going to be wanting to look at, especially in the Trump era. But I wanted to ask you specifically about the South, because you moved down to the South, right? You're in Mobile, Alabama. Is it Mobile?
I live in Mobile, Alabama. Uh-huh. Yes.
And what brought you down there, and what are the stories you tell people about how different it is?
Work. I mean, academic. I got an academic job.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to go where they go, where they're at. And I got a job at the University of South Alabama, and I like my job. I have fantastic students. Southern food is great.
Yeah. Did you have any family or experience in the South? Because I was one of these people. So one of the things we talk about in this show is like, the kind of like, I don't know, the kind of contours of being an academic in this particular era. And one of them is that this phenomenon that when I was in New York City in grad school, like everyone, all of us were talking about how, like, we're going to have to take jobs like wherever they are, and we're talking about like, would you go there? Would you go there? Would you go to the Pacific Northwest? How far would you go? What was your process on that? Because you ended up in Alabama, it sounds like a place that you didn't have any real connection to. That sounds scary to me. And how'd you do that?
It was terrifying.
Yeah.
I got the job interview here 1 month after I got married, and my wife is from Southern California and never had been to the South. And so 1 month after getting married, I said, "Hey, I got this prospect," and she's great, so she was totally she was willing to do it. I was like, I had all those conversations. Where are you willing to go? And I made up my mind a long time ago that if I wanted to have an academic career, I had to be willing to go wherever I could.
Yeah, yeah.
Wherever would accept me. And, you come in with all sorts. It's hard. I should know better, because I've read enough about the South and I know all these things. But you can't wipe the upbringing and the whatever cultural assumptions you have about the South when you move here. My adjustment to Mobile has been less that it's Southern and more that it's smaller.
I can see that.
I mean, I grew up in one of the biggest cities in the country, and Mobile just isn't. But it's, I'll say this about the South. The people I've met here, the activists, the progressives, the people who are committed to a better world, are the most committed people I've ever met.
I've heard that. We've had a couple of them on this program.
It's just like, and I guess this is an opinion. This isn't a scholarly. Anyway, it's just, I think it's a lot easier to be progressive in some places. It's hard. It's lonely. It's hard work to be progressive here, and the people who do it are more committed and more interested in justice and fairness and equality than almost anyone I've ever met. In the North and in Philly. I mean, that's not true. I met plenty of good activists in Philly, but I mean, I've been impressed.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's true. And there's a roots to it too, right? I mean, it feels like the South, I know we're talking like very broadly, but like I study the anti-war movement and the kind of, the larger kind of cultural revolution in the 1960s and 70s. And like that story always begins with the civil rights movement of the South, right?
Oh, absolutely.
It always begins with like all these like white middle-class kids, like being inspired by the civil rights movement and kind of taking the kind of structure and ideas from that movement and applying them in their own lives.
No, and if we only, I mean, like it's one patently ahistorical to only think of the conservative South. I mean, don't get me wrong, that's a big part of this,
right? Right.
But you can't. There is a progressive South, and there is a progressive South that historically is one of the guiding lights of any social justice in the United States,
totally.
And that's still, and the thing is, teaching here, you always try to, when you're teaching, you always try to pick readings and things that are that will, students are going to latch on to. So I've actually assigned in my classes a lot more Southern history than I have in the past.
That's cool. Yeah, I can imagine that.
What's the hook? What's the hook here? So we'll do, and it's been really, it's been you know, it's been good. You know, don't get me wrong. I could sit here and spend another 20 minutes telling you all the things I miss about Philadelphia and, you know, big cities up north. But, you know,
life takes you where it takes you, man.
Life takes you where it takes you.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can spend time complaining about it or you can enjoy it while you can.
Yeah. No, it sounds good to me. I was going to ask you one last thing in terms of your work. You've done this book on Frank Rizzo, and I'm at the same point where my book got published last year, and I'm now like, well, what do I do next? Are you thinking about a next project? Do you know what you might want to do next?
So I've got two. That I'm actively trying to work towards. I'm actually first working on a short piece that's going to be an edited collection on basically on African American politics in 20th century Philadelphia. Cool. And that is going to I'm doing a basically black politics in Frank Rizzo's Philadelphia, and I get to use a lot of the research. I think
that's awesome.
It's great. It's great. Like, this fell in my lap, and I was like, yes, I have all this research I can use.
So that's black politics in the age of Frank Rizzo.
That's going to be my
the other side of the coin.
Yeah. That's going to be my entry.
That's really cool.
And it's all the stuff I actually hint at in the book, but it's like, oh, I just can't put in there. So it's giving me opportunities. It's like, you know, just a nice little thing in an edited collection.
Right.
That'll be nice. But I have two other broader book projects that I'm interested in. One will seem intuitive. The other, the first is kind of an exploration of the broader connections between the Republican Party and the far right in mm-hmm. the late 20th century. You know, where has there been more overlap? And I think a lot of that grows out of 2016 mm. and what has happened and just trying to look for, you know, what is the broader history. So I mentioned earlier I had a dissertation right away.
Yeah, yeah.
That was on the far right.
The one that got away.
The one, and so I.
So you are interested in extremes of American politics.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other one is still a political history, but less so overtly. You know, because I'm also an urbanist, is looking at gentrification.
Cool.
Gentrification and urban renewal, specifically, however. Through the prism of the rise of craft brewing.
Craft brewing. That's always, you know what? That's always my go-to example whenever I tell people about in my classes about gentrification. I tell them, you know, the neighborhoods where the craft breweries are.
Yeah, and it's something I've noticed as well.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of factors. You know, there's the space, there's the everything, and so I'm doing that. There's a long-term project that. I don't know when, you know, I'm actually taking my first research trip later this month, later next month in February, actually, since you mentioned a few times, to Brooklyn.
Nice.
To Williamsburg.
I think there are a lot of craft breweries there.
Yeah, but specifically Brooklyn Brewing.
Yeah.
Which has been there since, well, founded in 88.
I've taken the tour.
And opened in the 90s, and mm-hmm. then you look at what Williamsburg was and what Williamsburg is.
Oh God, yeah.
And I, you know, there's a bunch of other of these all throughout the country that I think it's an interesting window into a broader revival of urban America in the late 20th and early 21st centuries, but also, you know, what are the consequences of those revivals and the complicated questions that come along with being an urbanist.
Yeah, that's so great. We got to have you back on the show to talk about all that stuff because I just moved from Brooklyn to Ventura, California, which is a place that since I moved from here and came back in the 15 years I was gone, the place exploded with craft breweries. It's like all over the place, and it's all like. It's mixed in with a kind of gentrification, startup culture, a lot of white guys with beards, and this kind of like, you know, wider thing that's going on. So I'd love to explore that stuff with you because I'm always thinking about it. I know there's more to think about with that stuff.
Every time I mention this project, I'm like, I promise you this is a research project, not an excuse for me to go drink beer.
Yeah, right.
but it is. I think it's just an interesting. I mean, like, I could probably do the same project about coffee shops or
totally.
Something like that.
Yeah.
I just thought this was an interesting avenue to sort of approach these questions of gentrification and new urbanism and culture and you know, if I have a running thread throughout all of these three works that I'm the one I've done and the two I'm working on, I guess if I have to identify myself some way, it's like, I guess I study the culture and politics of white people.
Mm. For better or worse?
For better or for worse, yeah.
Yeah. Well, Timothy Lombardo, I really enjoyed talking with you. Thank you so much for joining us.
This has been a lot of fun. This has been a great conversation. Thanks for having me.
Okay, I want to thank my guest, Timothy Lombardo. I had a great time talking with him. I feel like we have so much more to talk about in terms of unpacking the politics of the late 20th century and how that relates to what we're going through now. So thank you, Timothy, for explaining your book again, which is called Blue Collar Conservatism, Frank Rizzo's Philadelphia and Populist Politics. Check that out if you get a chance. Check out all our stuff on nostalgiatrap.com. Subscribe to the show if you can at patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. Thanks as always. We will talk again. Take care. Bye-bye.